Prabha Bhage Dvijamani Gora Amani Jage Udila runa pura babhage Dvijamani gora mani jage Vakata samuha loya state Gila nagara paje Bhakata samuha loya state Gila nagara paje Tatai bhajalako Ganagana tahe janjararo Preme dala dala sonarayanga Charanenu pora bhaje Makunda madhava yadavari Bolena bola revadana bari Micheni davase gelare rati divasa sariya saje Micheni davase gelare rati divasa Poya ki koro bhavana keo Ebena bhajile yasara sutta charane po vibe laje Udita tapana hoile asta Dina gela boile hoile bebyasta Udita tapana hoile asta Dina gela boile hoile Raje Jivana Nitya Janavasara Tahina Naviravi Parava Namashraya koriyatani tumi takata panakaje Namashraya koriyatani tumi Verakayana Sadavakam Jagate Ase Marhuyanam Avijati Mirata Panarupe Ridgagane Raje Krishna Nam Surakori Apan Chiro Bhakati Vinoda Pran Namash Namavina Kichu Nahiko Ara Chora Bhuvana Maje Shri Krishna Namavina Kichu Naiko Ara Chora Bhuvana Maje Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare Jaya Bhakti Vino, Jaya Bhakti Vino, Bhakti Vino, Jaya Bhakti Vino. Jaya Bhakti Vino, Bhakti Vino, Bhakti Vino, Jaya Bhakti Vino.
Well, I know all of us feel so much inspiration and nourishment by the words of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So if I can just read the first line of this song, I'll be satisfied. When a tinge of red on the eastern horizon heralded the rising sun, the jewel of the twice-born Lord Gorsundar immediately awakened. Taking his devotees with him, he went out over the countryside, visiting the towns and the villages of Nadia. I won't be satisfied. I have to read the whole thing. The mridangas resounded, tatai, tatai, and the cymbals chimed in time, and Lord Gauranga's footbells jingled as his golden form trembled slightly in ecstatic love of God. You have achieved a rare human body. Don't you care for this gift? If you do not serve... Oh, I missed a line, sorry. Lord Chaitanya called out to the townsfolks, "You spend your nights uselessly sleeping and your days decorating your bodies. Now just fill your mouths with the vibration of the holy names Mukunda, Madhava, Yadava, Hari. Chant without offense. You have achieved the rare human body. Don't you care for this gift? If you do not serve the darling of Yasoda, now great sorrow awaits you at death. Each time the sun rises and sets, a day passes and is lost. Then why do you remain idle and refuse to serve the Lord of the heart? Understand this essential fact. Life is temporary and full of all kinds of miseries. So make it your only business to take shelter of the holy name and always engage in his service. Desiring to bless all souls, the sweet name of Krishna has descended to the material world and now shine like the sun in the sky on the heart, destroying the darkness of ignorance. Drink the pure nectar of the holy name of Krishna and thus satisfy the soul of Bhaktivinoda. There is nothing but the holy name within all the 14 worlds. Bhaktivinoda Thakur ki jai. Hare Krishna. Welcome. I'll go take my seat over there.
Sit together. It's like the old days. Om Jnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Dena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasari Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. It's with the greatest pleasure today to glorify Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur on his Divine Disappearance Day. This day of the Tirubhav, when the great Acharya leaves the world, there's a way in which the devotees feel the greatest sadness out of separation, but at the same time there's an exhilaration from within. Because there's a realization that one must carry on the work of the Acharya. One of the reasons stated by some of our great Acharyas that other Acharyas leave the world specifically is then to test those who are the followers of the Acharya so that they can then take up the work and push it on. And factually, by taking up that work and going on with the mission of the Acharya, which doesn't mean just work, it means also taking seriously, as Bhaktivinoda Thakur has asked us in his prayers, the process of Krishna consciousness, meaning that one fully embrace the sadhana, which is passed down by the Acharya and prescribed, takes the medicine, and at the same time goes on with the work of spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. The proof of Bhaktivinoda Thakur's divinity and his succession from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as one of the great devotees of Govardhan Hill in modern history, even now, the temple president there, said that the lights are on. When he was talking to a devotee at Radhakund who was debating the different lines of disciplic succession this way and that way, the devotee said to him, "Just see, the lights are on." In Bhaktivinoda's Parivar, in his family that's come down from him, all over the world there's vibrancy. Just in the last weekend we had Rathiatras, devotees from every culture, dancing down Fifth Avenue in New York and ending up having a public kirtan for 10, 12 hours in the middle of New York City. That means the lights are on. And that was Bhaktivinoda Thakur's great mission. I was asking my friend Divyanga on the way here, I said, what is it that most impresses you about Bhaktivinoda Thakur? He said he wanted everyone to have Krishna consciousness. He wanted everyone to chant Hare Krishna. That means no envy within the heart. Oftentimes people take to a religious process and they think, just my people, we're the only chosen people. We have the only chosen acharya, we have the only chosen everything. And everybody else can go to hell as far as we're concerned. But the great acharyas like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, they're thinking in terms of, we want to see the Japanese and we want to see the Europeans and everybody else to come and dance together in Harinam. And they know that the pinnacle of perfection is this chanting of the Harinam. They know and follow the Bhagavatam, which says that this is the ultimate goal of life. And they know also that those who take part in it attain perfection. Their prarabdha karma is changed. They are no longer considered to be fallen, but they become elevated by the very process which Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave. So one of the desires of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which he specific of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, was that he specifically said that he wanted to see everyone from all the cultures come together and chant and sing the names of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and chant Hare Krishna. And now practically we see the lights are on. All over the world this is happening, and devotees are singing together in the streets of cities all over the world. Even in places where it's not legal, they're still going out and chanting Hare Krishna in the streets. Satyadev Prabhu, our main emissary to the east, we lend him every once in a while to other yatras. It goes all over China. I hope that's okay to say on the internet. But he goes all over China and meets with devotees and is seeing a great revolution there. Already revolution has taken place in the former Soviet Union. Devotees went in, and now there are tens of thousands of devotees practicing Krishna consciousness in Russia. So in one sense, Srila Prabhupada talked about Bhaktivinoda Thakur having the mood of Advaita Acharya. And this is the mood of Advaita Acharya. My Lord, please come and save these people. There's such a great need. Please come. If someone can accommodate that kind of desire in their heart, this is perfection of life. It means nindadi shunya. There's no more criticism or envy of other living entities. They want to see everybody rise. They want to see everybody become liberated and do well. That's the mood of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Advaita Acharya, who is the incarnation of Mahavishnu. And he prays over and over again, let there be an appearance of the Supreme Lord to distribute it to everybody. Let's see everybody happy. That's what the goal of the Vedic culture is, and of the Acharyas, see everybody actually happy and become free from the entanglement of the material world. So Prabhupada said that Bhaktivinoda Thakur was in the same mood as Advaita Acharya, because he was praying that please let a ray of Vishnu come. He had his program of spreading Krishna consciousness, and he was going about it methodically. But as most people encounter when they take up the process of spreading Krishna consciousness, we need help, and a lot of it, because it's one obstacle after another, not only in one's own personal practice, but also in spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. There's, as Prabhupada says in the Srimad Bhagavatam introduction, or one of his purports rather, a systematic program to stop the propagation of Krishna consciousness all over the world. Ultimately, that's the nature of the material world. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur was praying, let there be a ray of Vishnu. And in his family, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur appeared. And he was that ray of Vishnu, perfectly qualified in every way to carry on the work of Bhaktivinoda Thakur and extend that parampara to the world. And we've become the recipients of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, and their method of liberally spreading Lord Chaitanya's movement all over the world. So when Bhaktivinoda Thakur was preaching, similar to the times of Advaita Acharya, when people were ostentatiously practicing religious ceremonies. They were spending tons of money on weddings, and they didn't really care about advancement in Krishna consciousness. They were worshiping all kinds of demigods and images of snakes and so forth. And Advaitacharya said, bring the real thing, bring the Yuga Dharma, please come, and he was praying over and over again. At the time of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, there was a similar degradation. Although Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared only 500 years ago, as Krishna tells Sri Uddhava in the 11th canto of the Bhagavatam, there's the way in which the message of Krishna consciousness becomes distorted over time. It's the nature of the world. Even the Bhagavad Gita, we know Krishna's re-speaking it because yoga nashta parantapa, it's been lost. So it needs to be refreshed. So after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, there's a way in which his teachings, which had liberated everybody in the world, gradually became distorted, and 13 different sampradayas arose. By the time that Bhaktivinoda Thakur emerged as a great teacher of Krishna consciousness, he had to confront 13 very distinct movements that were offspring of the distorted teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If you want to know about those particular upper sampradayas, which is a good idea to study them, you can talk to Damodar Vamsidhari and purchase those books he brought today. I see them on the back. There's two sets of books back there, and you can purchase those. They're written by His Holiness Bhaktivikas Swami, who's a great scholar in his own right, and has written this beautiful biography of His Divine Grace, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. And within that book, there is a good education about our history, our parampara. You should all read the book. And in it, he delineates the various philosophies of the Upa Sampradaya. Sampradaya means that you're getting a bequeathment from the authorized chain coming from Krishna, and the Upa Sampradaya means you're getting ripped off. You're buying a counterfeit ticket. They've distorted it in some way due to personal interest and changed it, and therefore you're getting something different. And it's not according to the authorized process. So 13 distinct Upa Sampradayas were raging at the time of Bhaktivinoda Thakur's emergence. And he had the power, the wherewithal, to defeat them all. Not only were there Upa Sampradayas coming from the original teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but there were also concoctions coming from the intellectuals of the time who were making up a new kind of philosophy. For instance, Brahmoism, which was a concoction, a mixture of a kind of undifferenced monism or impersonalism, along with various philosophies of the Bhagavad Gita and other Vedic philosophies, all in a mishmash, kind of a khichdi, that they were presenting. There were a lot of pressures on people at the time in India that Bhaktivinoda Thakur began his teachings. It was a unique environment. One point was that the British, who had been ruling India for some time, had deliberately tried to undermine, and did, the culture of India by propaganda. On one side, you have the ruling government trying to distort the educational system so that people would give up their faith in the Bhagavat and in worshiping God as a person. And on another side, you had a myriad of various philosophies, which were concocted philosophies that had descended from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's original teachings, but were distorted. And on another side, you had intellectuals in society who were now making up new philosophies and promoting them as the way forward. It takes an acharya to rise up at that time to be able to handle all of those types of noise and to emerge and bring forward the real teachings. Interestingly, Bhaktivinoda Thakur had started from a point of seemingly being involved in worldly society, and then after studying all world religions and looking for a unifying force and discovering the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, he then brought forth the flag of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, much to the surprise of his peers in intellectual society. And he was a member of intellectual society in India. He was much revered even by the British government. There were not very many high positions available to Indian citizens at the time, but Bhaktivinoda Thakur held the highest position as a high court magistrate, which was unique. Not only that, he was much sought after because people liked him wherever he went. They liked the way he did his work. He was also the most efficient of all the high court judges, and he would solve more cases than anyone else and have fewer reversals on his cases, fewer appeals than anybody else. This is Vaishnav, means daksha, expert. And even when he wanted to give up his job, the British begged him over and over again, please stay in your job, we need you. He asked for concession to be transferred to near Jagannath Puri and received it. Whatever he wanted, they would give him because he was such a valuable person. And he was known in Indian society as one of the greatest intellectuals of the time, progressively spiritual person, and was involved in all the conversations of the time and all the debates going on. So when he came back as a Chaitanya Vaishnav, amidst an atmosphere where people at that time who were thinking people actually abhorred Vaishnavism because of all the misrepresentation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teachings, they were shocked. But that's how he emerged, and he began teaching about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. One of the ways in which the distorted teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's philosophy became so pervasive was because many, many literatures were produced in simple language, but they distorted the whole philosophy. Interestingly, I was listening this morning to the Adi Lila of the Chaitanya Charitamrita, and Srila Prabhupada was talking about how it's such a simple process. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu brought chant Hare Krishna, and then he was saying that we've reduced the number of rounds in japa to 16 rounds, and he said he was talking to his disciples at the time, and you can't even do that. And he said, and you're bringing so many austere books and reading those instead of chanting. And it made me think about how everyone wants to go off and find some edge. They want to find a way to beat the system and be smarter than everybody else and get the inside track and read so many things. But the simple thing is chant Hare Krishna. And there's a few books that if you just read and stick with them, you'll become perfectly happy and Krishna conscious, and you'll know everything anyway. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur brought this simple path, and he used to say, strictly follow the simple path. And imagine what that's like. One personality who's so much revered in society coming forward and then carrying the flag of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu all by himself and beginning to spread Krishna consciousness. What is one of the main ways that he spread Krishna consciousness? Writing books. Bhaktivinoda Thakur had a busy schedule. Anybody here have more than 7 kids? Huh? It feels like 7? Bhaktivinoda Thakur had 10 children. He was a high court judge. And he wrote over 100 books of Vaishnava philosophy. One of the lessons that he teaches is something that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, or one of the lessons that he is an exemplar of, is what Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Kiva Vipra Kiva Nyasi Shudra Kena Noi, Se Krishna Tattva Veta Se Guru Hoi, Ye Krishna Tattva Veta Se Guru Hoi. Means that doesn't matter what position you're in life, you can be Kiva Vipra Kiva Nyasi. You can be a Vipra, you can be a renunciate, you can be a Shudra. It doesn't matter. But if you know the science of Krishna, and you're practicing the science of Krishna through and through, you're ready to spread the movement. You're ready to be a guru. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur was such a person that had so much responsibility on his head to manage a family of 10 and to maintain a very high-level job, the highest of responsibility. And at the same time, he occupied his mind with chanting Hare Krishna. I was thinking about how to do that the other day, and I saw this little film somebody sent me of how to cut up a pomegranate. Do you know how to cut a pomegranate? I never knew until I saw this little video. These things float across the internet. It's like, why? There's so many ways to do things. How am I going to learn everything in life? But a pomegranate, there's a way you peel it and peel it, peel it. I used to be frustrated. I never touched the things because I can never get anything out of them. So it's because how do you get those little seeds to come out? But I watched this little video, and they cut this way, that way, peel, and then they all just fall out. They're all just available. But when I looked inside, there's all these little segments inside the pomegranate, perfect segments. And I was thinking, that's like my brain. And there's so many duties that one has to do in life. You all are following in the footsteps of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. You're working hard. You're working at these high-level jobs, every one of you. And at the same time, you're maintaining families. And at the same time, you're spreading Krishna consciousness and doing projects and thinking how to do more. And I was meditating on how does one continue to do that? And the only way is you have to kind of expand your brain and have all those compartments in perfect order. Bhaktivinoda Thakur showed how to do that, that he kept everything in his life in order and he dedicated everything to spreading Krishna consciousness. So what an example of how to live in the world and at the same time be a follower of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So his schedule is described how he would go to work and do what he had to do, and then he would come home, take care of the family, have some prasadam, do all his sadhana, take a couple hours of rest, and then write his books in the wee hours of the night. And over 100 books Bhaktivinoda Thakur produced. And he was interested in seeing people all over the world read those books. One of them reached the McGill University in Canada. It was in the library there until some devotee went in and purloined it. He apparently sent books to great scholars in different places, Thoreau, Emerson, and so forth, thinkers of the time. He wanted them to read about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And this was his life. It was a great force for spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. So there's a few excerpts I want to read to you from what Prabhupada said about Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And if you could get Radha Krishna Bull ready in the PowerPoint, do we have that? Because we have to sing that. Prabhupada is speaking. This body is perishable. Nitya syokta sharininaha. But the proprietor of the body, that is eternal. Vani and vapu. And vapu means the physical body, and vani means vibration. So we are not concerned about the physical body. Not concerned means we are concerned, of course, because the spiritual master, those who are acharyas, their body is not considered as material. Arche shila dhira gurushu naramatir. Just like the statue of Krishna, to consider that this is stone. Similarly, arche shila dhira gurushu na. Gurusha means those who are acharyas, to accept their body as ordinary man's body. This is denied in the Shastra. So although a physical body is not present, the vibration should be accepted as the presence of the spiritual master, vibration. What we have heard from the spiritual master, that is living. You'll see in these pictures, this movement was started by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and then it was entrusted to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. Then we are trying to serve his word, and many of my godbrothers, they are also. This is from a talk Prabhupada gave in New York in 1969, talking about Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And we'll find that Srila Prabhupada had to leave his fledgling disciples and go back to India because his health had begun to deteriorate when he was in America. And Brahmananda Prabhu, the great servitor of Srila Prabhupada, who first came and who was instrumental in helping spread Srila Prabhupada's movement, bring out the Bhagavad Gita, so many things it's impossible to name them all. A great soul who just recently left from Sri Vrindavan Dham, was asking Prabhupada, what will we do now without you? Imagine, now we have some infrastructure, we have some association, we have books, we have a morning program, we have the framework of Krishna consciousness pretty much clearly in mind. If it's not clearly in mind, you're not paying attention. but back then, it was just Prabhupada and the devotees. They were fully dependent on him. He had instilled faith in their hearts, and they were listening carefully to him, but he was everything to them. And then he had to go back to India, and it wasn't certain if he was going to come back again because his body was really old and his health was failing even at that early stage. He had already suffered a couple of heart attacks. So when he told the devotees, the few devotees that were there, that he had to go back, and they were supposed to carry on the movement. They had only been there for 2.5-3 years. And now you carry on and do everything. And they asked, how will we do that? And Prabhupada said that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, they're there to look out for you. He said, I have asked them to watch out for you. And Prabhupada said similar things in various circumstances. Once in Mayapur, when he was on a morning walk, I happened to be part of a kirtan to greet Prabhupada when he was coming back from his morning walk at the Mayapur Chandradari Mandir. And he stopped and looked at the kirtan, which was all Sankirtan devotees who were very excited to be there. And it was as they say, rip-roaring kirtan. And we saw Prabhupada stop and say some things to the sannyasis that he was walking with. And later on, we heard what he said, that they had mentioned, some of the sannyasis, that just see, all these devotees have come here to Mayapur Dham. And Prabhupada said, yes, I have brought them. Now it is up to Bhaktivinoda Thakur to deliver them. So there's this interchange with the previous acharyas. As Prabhupada's saying in this paragraph, it is not a physical relationship. Of course, the physical relationship is there and is important in the vapu. To be able to see a pure devotee, the Shastra says, is the perfection of the eyes. There's a way in which, by a little bit of association, even if it's a 14th of a fraction of a second, one can feel this impression by being in the presence of a devotee. But even when it's not there, there's this connection that we have to the previous acharyas. They're eternal associates of the Lord, and their goodwill is there, available to everyone who comes forward and takes advantage of the process which they have laid before us. The Srimad Bhagavatam, the demigods praying to Lord Krishna within the womb, give a verse which describes how the acharyas, they make a boat so that anyone can easily cross the ocean of material existence. And that boat is so powerful that if you simply approach the boat, that means that you have the desire, I'm going to follow these great acharyas. You have faith in them. And you go for the boat. At the time you're stepping into the boat, the ocean shrinks. It becomes the size of the water within the hoofprint of a calf. And this is the power of the acharyas. They give this process. And if one simply develops faith in the process and has the intention that I am going to follow this process given by the acharyas, then one is assured of success. This is the guarantee given in the Srimad Bhagavatam by following the great souls. So Prabhupada is indicating this relationship that we have. It's a non-physical relationship. He goes on from there. In this way, there was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time. This Krishna consciousness movement was going nicely, very. And after him, there were the six Goswamis. They also managed. Then, as it is the rule of this material world, that you start something very good, but in due course of time, the things deteriorate. So this Vaishnav Krishna consciousness movement also deteriorated in due course of time. Say, after the disappearance of the Goswamis, about 250 years after, the things became most ridiculous. The so-called devotees, their representatives, still are continuing. They are called Prakrita Sahajya. Prakrita Sahajya means taking things very easily. They thought that Radha Krishna is just like a boy and girl's lusty affairs. And in this way, they took it that sex life as religion. Even Vivekananda, he also criticized, Vaishnavism is sex religion. So the things deteriorated in such a way, and similarly, as Advaita Prabhu was afflicted, similarly, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he was at that time a householder, government officer, and magistrate. He felt very much, oh, Lord Chaitanya's movement is so people, as soon as one will see that he belongs to Chaitanya Sampradaya, he'll deride, oh, these are all rascals, simply taking sex pleasures, that's all. There were 13 pseudo-Vaishnava, 13 sects, as I mentioned before. I want to go back to this comparison. Prabhupada says, and similarly, Advaita Prabhu and Bhaktivinoda Thakur, they were similarly afflicted. Afflicted with what? Most people are afflicted because they're attached to the tiny little situation that they have, the little corner spot they have, and they don't want anybody to rock the boat. But the Vaishnavas are afflicted because of the sufferings of others. They're paradukaduki. They've given up all other considerations for this one consideration. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Ananyas chintayanto mam yejana pariupasate, tesham nityabdi yuktanam yogik shemam bahamyaham. If someone gets in this mood that I'm just going to focus my attention on serving Krishna, and I'm going to focus my attention on helping others come to Krishna consciousness, that's the kind of devotee that Krishna says, well, I'll just take care of him. You don't worry about a thing. In fact, we were reading in the Chaitanya Charitamrita Antyalila recently at Govardhan Hill, fairly recently, last year, in October, where Prabhupada said, when a devotee becomes thus absorbed in thinking about how to spread the Krishna consciousness movement, the devotee no longer has time to take care of himself. It's not a choice. You just don't have any more time. It's like, you don't have time. So Krishna comes and helps at that point and takes care of the devotee. This is affliction. And this mode of meditation is what Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, what Srila Prabhupada taught, as the topmost kind of meditation. Prabhupada says in his Srimad Bhagavatam commentary, in the fourth canto, that the kind of affliction that one gets by wanting to see that other people get as Krishna consciousness, and you want them to have it as soon as possible, and you want everybody to have it as soon as possible. This is the kind of affliction that Prabhupada calls samadhi. He interchanges the words that are mentioned in the Yoga Sutras and everywhere else, where you sit by yourself and you try to conquer the mind and so forth. He says that when you become afflicted with this idea that I have to give Krishna consciousness to others, just as Bhaktivinoda Thakur was afflicted and Advaita Acharya was afflicted, that kind of absorption Prabhupada calls samadhi. And this is Krishna conscious samadhi, this kind of service attitude. Now, one thing I've noticed is that in Las Vegas, not to change the subject, there's a lot of bells ringing in Las Vegas, Nevada. They do it purposefully. In Las Vegas, Nevada, they have these casinos, and all day and all night, and you don't know if it's day or night because they don't have any clocks purposely inside, but they have the bells ringing from the slot machines going all the time. You can hear them everywhere. And I didn't go there to gamble, by the way. I had business. And people become, psychologists say they become addicted to it, and they get addicted to the bells. Does this sound familiar? The bell, I hope not. The bells, the bells are ringing, and there's an addictive feeling. People become afflicted by this. They'll spend their whole life and all their money inside the casino, and the bells get in them. They start thinking, you know, I got to hear those bells. It's a kind of intoxication. It's kind of a fulfillment of the mode of passion that is, you know, that they want to be there, and the excitement of the gambling and the bells ringing. And, you know, I was experiencing something similar. I was concentrating on writing, and then I was realizing, why don't I turn off my phone? Because it's ringing. The bells are ringing from WhatsApp every 5 seconds. WhatsApp is an application which was specifically designed for Sankirtan parties around the world so the devotees can be in touch constantly about how many books they're distributing and how to organize more. And every time someone sells a book or has some glorification of someone who just sold a book, the bell rings. And it's a nice kind of sound. It almost sounds like these bells here. Or it almost sounds like the bells you hear at the slot machines in Las Vegas. And I was thinking, why don't I turn off the phone? It's like, I want to hear the bells. I'm getting addicted to those bells. There's an exhilaration. And I was thinking how the devotees become absorbed in this kind of mood. We want to hear the bells ringing all the time. The books are going out. The devotees are meeting people at their doors. They're sending back pictures and so forth. This is a kind of affliction that Bhaktivinoda Thakur was talking about. And Prabhupada's mentioning here that Advaita Acharya had, that Bhaktivinoda Thakur had, that they're burning inside because they want to see it go out. They can't stand not seeing it. It's like a drought, and they want to see the rains come into the lives of people. So these are the great acharyas. They have complete room and capacity to feel like this for the people all over the world. And such a feeling actually is so rare. And it's so powerful that it spreads, it turns into a movement, and then it accommodates all kinds of people who can actually follow that, and it gives them service. It gives them service to follow in the footsteps. And that brings up another point about this seva that we have for the great acharyas. A devotee is asking, they weren't pure devotees right from the beginning. Wait, I'm sorry, that's a different one. Yeah, here it is. Vishnu Jana, the famous sannyasi from ISKCON. Everyone knows Vishnu Jana. There's a book about him you can read. One of the great heroes of the Krishna consciousness movement. He's speaking to Srila Prabhupada about unfinished work. Srila Prabhupada, what did Bhaktivinoda Thakur mean when he said, I'm going, my work unfinished. Prabhupada says, And Vishnu Jana says again, when Bhaktivinoda Thakur stated that he was leaving this planet with his work unfinished, Prabhupada, then let us finish. We are descendant of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So he kept unfinished so that we shall get the chance to finish it. That is his mercy. He could have finished it immediately. He is Vaishnava. He is all powerful. But he gave us chance that you foolish people, you all also work. That is his mercy. So we should pray to Bhaktivinoda Thakur that we are your grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So we have got some right to beg some mercy from you. Isn't this nice? He is saying at the time, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Now there's great-great-grandchildren. And there's even great-great-great-grandchildren. And we have got some right to beg some mercy. This is intimacy. When you have service, you have intimacy. And if you have the right to come to a great acharya, like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and say, please, give me some service. That's the greatest request that you can make. And he's left service for us here. We are your grandchildren, great-grandchildren, so we have got some right to beg some mercy from you. The grandchildren get some indulgence from the grandfather. So I pray like that. Prabhupada is speaking. It is Bhaktivinoda Thakur's mercy. A Vaishnav can. Krishna doesn't require anyone's help. Still, he's asking, surrender to me. He doesn't require anyone's surrender. But it's good for him, good, one who surrenders. Not Krishna is in need of anyone's service. He is complete. But he comes as if he is in helpless condition and asking for us to surrender. So that is for his good. One who is surrendered, he'll get the result. Krishna is self-sufficient. Similarly, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is self-sufficient. But if he said that, I am keeping unfinished, that means he gave us the chance, the opportunity. So we should always pray to Bhaktivinoda Thakur to be merciful upon us so that we can execute his unfinished task. That should be our, and never should we think that what Bhaktivinoda Thakur could not finish, I have finished. Then Prabhupada laughs. Don't think like that. It's not like that. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Eka kiyamar nahi pai. It goes on to a different topic. So this is what the prayer is on these special days, that please let me follow in your footsteps. Let me take some service in your mission. And this connects us to Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And just a couple of very important lessons that are so simple but so profound that Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives in his teachings. One comes from the Harinam Chintamani, which is a very important book about chanting the holy names of the Lord. So many books. All of the books are a lifetime of study of Krishna consciousness. Jivadharma, all of the songs of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and hundreds more books that he wrote. One point that is worth taking as a sutra to keep in mind about the importance of sincere devotional service. In the Harinam Chintamani, Bhaktivinoda Thakur mentions the qualities of a Vaishnav, 26 qualities. And one of the qualities that is mentioned amongst the 26 is Krishna Ek Sharana, exclusive surrender to Krishna. Then there's 25 more. And he says there that if you have that one quality in your heart, that I'm going to surrender to Krishna, come hell or high water, but you don't have the other 25, still you're a sadhu. He's talking about who's a sadhu. He's in this section of the Harinam Chintamani, he's talking about sadhu ninda and how this destroys your ability to chant the holy name of the Lord and perform devotional service. So then he says, who's a sadhu? So one of the ways in which he describes what a sadhu is that if somebody has this intention that I'm going to surrender to Krishna, I don't care who says what when, but I'm surrendering. I'm going to sign that little sheet that they have out in front that says, I surrender. Put my name on there. If the other 25 qualities aren't there, the expertise, the poetic nature, so many other embellishments, it doesn't matter. That person's still a sadhu. And if the other 25 are there and you're missing that one, you don't have anything. This is the mood of the pure devotees. They know the essence of everything. And this was Bhaktivinoda Thakur's mood in teaching Krishna consciousness. Throughout his books, this mood is pervasive about full surrender to Krishna. being the goal of life. And he simplified everything. You don't have to be a great scholar. You don't have to be a genius. You just have to be a little wise and take hold of some of his teachings. Some of the most profound teachings come in his songs. And did I write them down? One comes from his own life. This is an exemplar that he had many difficulties in life. Prabhupada said, don't think just because you're a Vaishnava, you won't have difficulties in your life. Is that all right? Does that fit? Okay. It's number one frequently asked question. I'm a devotee, or such and such a devotee, why are there so many troubles? He said, don't think there won't be difficulties. It's the nature of the world that there's difficulties. But the difference is, and we can see in the life of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, that he went on with Krishna consciousness despite the difficulties. That's simple enough. That's simple enough. And that's all that's required. Is to just go on chanting Hare Krishna to the best of your ability and doing service at your level best, whatever that is, because birds fly in the sky as high as they're able to do. Some can go higher and some go lower. If you're able to go on, then you are perfectly situated in Krishna consciousness. And he showed that by his life's example. He also showed how to use your time properly. This is one of the number one questions that people have all over the world. How do I use my time properly so that I don't lament at the time of death? Of course, no one's asking that. Everyone thinks I'll live forever. But intelligent people think, how should I properly use my time? Look at the life of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. He put everything together, and he also talks about how a householder or anybody involved in the world and who isn't, to one degree or another, can live and be in Krishna consciousness. And he said, the things that you have to do, the kind of association that you have with family members who are not interested in Krishna consciousness, with co-workers who are not interested in Krishna consciousness, does not violate the principle of pure devotional service. He said, you're doing that officially. And Prabhupada says, when they say this or that, you say, yes, sir, very good, but you go on with your Krishna consciousness. And he also said that whatever you have to do to maintain yourself, this is pursuant to the Lord Rishabhadev's teachings and many others from the Srimad Bhagavatam, whatever you have to do to maintain yourself, your body and soul together, so that you can go on practicing Krishna consciousness. Don't take more, don't take less. That's also counted in the line of pure devotional service, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur gave us those teachings. And to the very practical, esoteric, but very simple instructions, he said, there's nothing else to be had in the 14 worlds except the holy name. Now just meditate on that all day long, because everything else is substandard, and it's way substandard. But if you take the holy name as the main objective in your life and you organize yourself around that principle, then you will come to the highest position of advancement in devotional service and go back home, back to Godhead. And if you'll hand me the Sharanagati, I will read the last installment that Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote about the process of surrender and what it leads to, the life of simply organizing your time around this principle of chanting Hare Krishna. And that is that you won't lack for anything on any level, and you'll also attain complete success in Krishna consciousness. As I'm flipping through the book, I just see a hit parade going by. Every one of the songs is one we just want to sing until the roof blows off, right? This song is very sobering. His Sharanagati begins with the process of humility, in which Bhaktivinoda Thakur is lamenting his situation. He's showing this as an example that one should be meek and humble always and consider oneself extremely lowly And he goes on through the various processes of surrender in Krishna consciousness, which are all possible simply by following the footsteps of the acharyas who have passed down this process to us. And then he talks at the very last in his Sharanagati about the power of the holy name, chanting Hare Krishna. And here's the translations to his verse called Sri Nam Mahatmya. What power does the name of Krishna possess? My heart constantly burns in the fire of worldly desires, just like a desert scorched by the rays of the sun. The holy name entering the core of my heart through the holes of my ears showers unparalleled nectar upon my soul. The holy name speaks from within my heart, moves onto the tip of my tongue, and constantly dances on it in the form of transcendental sound. My throat becomes choked up, my body shivers again and again, and my feet cannot remain still. Rivers of tears flow from my eyes, perspiration completely soaks my body, all my skin thrills with rapture, my hairs stand on end, and my complexion turns pale and discolored. My mind grows faint. I begin to experience devastation, and my entire body is shattered in a flood of ecstatic emotions. While causing such an ecstatic disturbance, the holy name showers liquid nectar on my heart and drowns me in the ocean of divine love of Godhead. He does not allow me to understand anything, for he has made me truly mad by having stolen away my mind and my resources. Such is the behavior of him in whom I have taken shelter. I'm not capable of describing all this. The holy name of Krishna is independent and thus acts on his own sweet will. In whatever way he becomes happy, that is also my way of happiness. The holy name is the bud of the flower of divine love and is the very abode of astonishing mellows. Such is the power he manifests that when his holy name starts to blossom a little further, it then reveals his own divine form and qualities. Thus my heart is abducted and taken directly to Krishna. Blossoming fully, the flower of the holy name takes me to Vraj and reveals to me his own love dalliance. This name gives to me my own eternal spiritual body, keeps me right by Krishna's side, and completely destroys everything related to this mortal frame of mine. The name of Krishna is a transcendental touchstone, a mine of all transcendental mellows. It is eternally liberated and the embodiment of pure rasa. When all impediments to the pure chanting of the holy name are taken away and destroyed, then my happiness will know its true awakening. Thus ends Sharanagati by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Hare Krishna. And now we're going to take some reflections just before we sing a bhajan.
I like the point that you have to continue chanting Hare Krishna in spite of difficulties, because difficulties present themselves in different forms. But if we have to have a hope that continue chanting Hare Krishna in spite of difficulties, and devotees also have difficulties all the time, it's not that we are free from difficulties.
That's a simple teaching, isn't it? Just keep on keeping on. Stay with it. It's the stuff your coach tells you when you come back to the sideline. He says, stay with it. Just stay in the game. Keep your head in the game and keep going. And if you do that, everything will come by Krishna's grace. Thank you. Yes. Naveena Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. I like the point a lot when you mentioned that when you have service, you have intimacy. I felt there was an opening there. There was really something moving. And that when you have the service and you've taken it to heart, then you also have the right to pray for the mercy of the acharya. Because sometimes people come and they say, oh, ashirvat, this, that. And then the person says, well, okay, here is some service. And they say, ah, no, I don't want the service. I just want the blessings, you know. just give me something cheap. And they don't understand that when you take the service, that is the blessing. So I really like that point.
Nice.
Thank you.
Two really winning points. Thank you. Kanka?
To add to what he said was that you were talking about considering Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur as the grandfather or the great-grandfather and how they benedict us with special. There was a time when Srila Prabhupada wrote a letter to my husband and I, and he said, follow in the footsteps of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. He was such a perfect householder, and he gave such a great example of how to be a Krishna-conscious householder. So we're so fortunate to have him as our grandfather, our great-grandfather.
And you're fortunate to have that letter. And to share it with everyone else. And as a devotee was saying recently, when a letter would come to a devotee in the temple, it was one of the main means of hearing from Prabhupada, and devotees would sort of gather around and hear the contents of the letter. In other words, it belonged to everybody. Everyone took it. Although it was a personal letter to one person, the whole community would absorb it and go on. And it just shows how valuable taking any simple instruction through the parampara from the spiritual master is, that one can keep one's devotional service very much vibrant. Thank you very much, Kanka. Yes?
I like that you said out of the 25 qualities, if one has the quality of surrendering to Krishna, he's a sadhu, but even if he has all the other qualities and he's not surrendered, he has nothing.
Yes. And Krishna says that in the Bhagavad Gita. Api chet sudaracharo bhajate ma mananyabhak sadareva samantavya samyag vyavasito hisaha. Api chet means even if. Even if someone is sudarachara, externally they may have all kinds of worldly qualities and problems and so forth. But if in their heart they're rightly situated, their determination is that they're going to go on with their devotional service, and they keep coming back to that point of surrender, then Krishna says that person is a sadhu. I want to make one other point about the acharyas, and that is, because I spoke that verse from the Bhagavad Gita, it reminded me that oftentimes Prabhupada would level very heavy criticisms against people in the world who were sometimes considered to be great religionists by the public. And oftentimes people would complain and they'd say, why are you saying this? And he's saying, I'm not saying it, Krishna is saying it. Namam duskritina muda prapadyante naradama. And you'll find that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur similarly stood up to many aprasampradayas. He wrote about them, he challenged them in public. It doesn't mean when you're a sadhu that you're reticent or you step back from the fray. It rather means you don't go on your own behalf, you go on behalf of your spiritual master and you go on behalf of Krishna. And when there is a point to be made, you must make it. And when the point happens to challenge somebody else's philosophy, you have to, of course, artfully, and realization means it must be done so that it can be heard properly and so forth. But that is something that acharyas do. They stand up on behalf of Krishna. And apparently to some people who don't understand what the meaning of a sadhu is, they think, oh, this person's criticizing. Sadhu should just be like, everything's fine, no problem, I won't say anything. But the sadhus, the acharyas, like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, and so forth, they would become very strong in preaching on behalf of Krishna. Yes, from the internet. We welcome everyone who's joined us tonight via the internet. Very happy to be connected with you.
So Maharaj, there's a text from Africa.
From Africa. Let's give Africa a hand. Haribo! Come on, it's Africa, a little more.
Haribo!
So I can see Bhaktivinoda Thakur's mercy is flowing to Ramananda Sakha Prabhu, definitely spreading Krishna consciousness using technology so well. There's one more text, and that is from Jalpa Mataji, from Sacramento.
What was the one from Africa?
Oh, sorry. It said, when are you coming to Africa?
I say we all go. Let's go on a yatra. That's our next yatra. We're going to Africa.
So I don't know. Jalpa Mataji has disappeared. Can you just check and see? And then I have a reflection. Guru Maharaj, I got a new pair of glasses today. And when I came into the class, I was just looking around and seeing everything I can see so clearly. And then you said that to see a pure devotee is the perfection of the eyes. So I was just reflecting on that, that, you know, that is real perfection.
Yeah, and there's a lot of metaphors about glasses and lenses and so forth, that it appears to be something in front and another layer, but actually it gives clarity. So there's a way through our acharyas, you know, the parampara system. Prabhupada mentions this at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, that Srila Vyasadeva's mercy allowed Sanjaya to see directly. And Prabhupada said, it's indirect, but then it becomes direct. And how do you understand that? With lenses. These cameras, the very nice cameras, they have one lens after another, say, so many obstructions. No, it's not an obstruction. It actually makes it clearer and closer. Yeah.
Thank you.
And
much.
Jalpa is there?
Yeah, Jalpa Mataji from Sacramento.
Wow. Very nice.
She says, I like the point that service is a blessing.
Service is a blessing, yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. As you were mentioning as you were giving the talk on the life of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, one thing that struck my mind was how Bhaktivinoda Thakur used to perform his duties in an immaculate manner, so that he would have extra time to do the Krishna conscious activities. So it is not like, I mean, every time we just have going to our work, and it's like not like, oh, just do them half-hearted so that we can spend more time. No, but doing it extra well, or doing it in a very efficient way so that we have more time for doing. That's a great thing to learn, as I was just reflecting on that. So, thank you.
Yeah, it's a nice and very practical point, how to balance our lives and be Krishna conscious at the same time. Yeah, a couple more?
Maharaj, whole lecture was nice, but I really like the practical definition you given, the Srila Prabhupada given about samadhi. Samadhi means like how you are thinking 24 hour absorbed in Krishna, how to spread Krishna consciousness. And you told how Bhaktivinoda Thakur and all the great acharya, they were afflicted because they were saying that people should become immediately Krishna conscious, and everyone should become Krishna consciousness. And when we get that kind of feelings, we can also be in the practical samadhi in this age. And and then you also compare that how WhatsApp group hour, you can see that practical comparison between them.
Yeah, it was not. I guess in thinking about the WhatsApp example, it was a very personal, practical experience. But I was also seeing how the devotees are becoming addicted to the process of spreading Krishna consciousness. There's a lot of joy in it. The devotees working together, going out, thinking about how to give it to other people. And that's why the bell's ringing so much. It's not hard work. It's not drudgery. It's something that the devotees are being carried along on the wings of the spiritual energy. Yes, Sukeshri.
I really like the point when you mentioned that Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he didn't do it incomplete because he couldn't do it. And I was thinking about the point of where, when we bake with kids at home, we make all the batter, we get everything ready, and they actually, probably make two or three of them with their hands and leave it on the plate. And when the cookies or cake come out, they just tell everybody, I made it. So I was just thinking that, when I go on book distribution, it's just the Bhaktivinoda Thakur's mercy. That he gives us that little bit of feeling that I did it, but it's actually not. He's
like
already taking care of it.
To extend it a little, and while you were saying that, I was thinking of all the devotees who have worked so hard, to put the books together. Think, I distribute a book. Where did it come from? And how many, what teamwork there was to actually put that together. And you're actually carrying the force of all that service, of all those Vaishnavas, the whole parampara, both the ancient parampara and the present parampara, everyone together, that's coming through the force. You're carrying that with you. All the efforts is concentrated within there. Nice example. I like that. Yeah. Are you ready to go? Go ahead. Yes. Charu.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. I like that point you said that when you follow the Acharya and you just go to the boat, the whole ocean shrinks. I mean, that is like a bottom of everything or the essence of the whole thing, that we are here for a purpose and that purpose is served by following Acharya's instructions.
Yeah. Mukharvin, get me that verse, please, 11th canto. What is it? No, that's a different one. 11th canto. Anyway, bring me the shloka book. I'll show it to you and you can find it. Yes, thank you. Nice point. Very nice.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. I really like the point when you said that father, great-grandfather, and great-great-grandfather, how nice it is that we with really head up and we can say that our great-grandfather gives us such teachings that you just surrender to the Almighty and you will lead your life well. And this was one point which I really liked.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Twayambu Jakshak, Kila Sattvadamni Samadina Veshit Chaitasayake, Tot Pada Potena Mahat Kritena Kurvanti Govatsa Padam Bhavabdim. This is the demigods praying to Lord Krishna within the womb. It is from the 10th canto, I misspoke, 10 to 30. It's the demigods speaking to Lord Krishna within the womb. O lotus-eyed Lord, by concentrating one's meditation on your lotus feet, which are the reservoir of all existence, and by accepting those lotus feet as the boat by which to cross the ocean of nations, one follows in the footsteps of the Mahajans, great saints, sages, and devotees. By this simple process, one can cross the ocean of nations as easily as one steps over the footprint of a calf. Purport. Srila Prabhupada's purport. The true mission of life is to cross the ocean of nations of repeated birth and death. Those in the darkness of ignorance, however, do not know this mission. Instead, being carried away by the waves of material nature, prakrite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashaha, they are undergoing the tribulations of mrityu sangsara vartmani, repeated birth and death. But persons who have achieved knowledge by the association of devotees follow the Mahajans, mahatkritena. Such a person always concentrates his mind upon the lotus feet of the Lord and executes one or more of the nine varieties of devotional service. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Pada, Sevanam. Simply by this process, one can cross the insurmountable ocean of nations. Devotional service is powerful in any form. Sri Vishnu Shravane Parikshit Abhavad Vayasaki Kirtane from the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. According to this verse, Maharaj Parikshit became liberated by fully concentrating his mind on hearing the Lord's holy name, attributes, and pastimes. Similarly, Shukadev Goswami similarly glorified the Lord, and by speaking on the subject matters of Krishna that constitute the entire Srimad Bhagavatam, he too was liberated. One may also be liberated simply by sakya, friendly behavior with the Lord, such as the power of devotional service, and we learn from the example set by the Lord's many pure devotees. Swayambhur Narada Shambhu Kumara Kapilo Munuhu Prahlado Janako Bhishmo Bhalirvaya Sakirvayam. We have to follow in the footsteps of such devotees, for by this one easy process, one can cross the great ocean of nations just as one might cross a small hole created by the hoof of a calf. Here the Lord is described as Ambujaksha, or lotus-eyed. By seeing the eyes of the Lord, which are compared to lotus flowers, one becomes so satisfied that one does not want to turn his eyes to anything else. Simply by seeing the transcendental form of the Lord, a devotee is at once fully absorbed in the Lord in his heart. This absorption is called samadhi. Dhyana avastita tad gatina manasa pashanti yam yogina. A yogi is fully absorbed in thoughts of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, for he has no other business than to think of the Lord always within the heart. It is also said, Samashita ye padapalava plavam mahatpanam punyasho marareh bhavam buddhir vatsapadam param padam padam panam yad vipadam nate sham. For one who has accepted the boat of the lotus feet of the Lord, who is the shelter of the cosmic manifestation and is famous as Murari, the enemy of the demon Mura, the ocean of the material world is like the water contained in a calf's hoofprint. His goal is Parampadam, or Vaikuntha, the place where there are no material miseries, not the place where there is danger at every step. This process is recommended here by authorities like Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, Swayambhur Narada Shambhu. And therefore, we must take to this process in order to transcend nescience. This is very easy, but we must follow in the footsteps of great personalities, and then success will be possible. In regard to the word Mahatkritena, it is also significant that the process shown by great devotees is not only for them, but also for others. If things are made easy, this affords facility for the person who has made them easy, and also for the others who follow the same principles. The process recommended in this verse for crossing the ocean of nescience is easy not only for the devotee, but also for the common persons who follow the devotee. Mahajano yena gata sapantaha. And it is in the Krishna book when Prabhupada's commenting on this particular verse in the second chapter of the 10th of the Krishna book that he says that the boat shrinks to the size, the water shrinks to the size of hoofprint in the calf. Do we have time for one bhajan? Or are we out of time now? Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Shika diya, shabna diya, reche neche gornitai. More kartal. Hari bo bolore shikadiya. Radha Krishna bol bol bolore shobha. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Niche mayar boshe chacho beshe kacho habu dubu bai. Hari bo bolo re miche mayar boshe. Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Jeev Krishna das hey vishwas kole toar duko nai. Hari bo bolo re jeev Krishna das. Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol Bolo Re Shobai. Krishna bulbe jabe, pulakka habe, jorbi anki bolitai. Krishna bulbe jabe, pulakka habe, jorbi anki bolitai. Pulakka habe, jorbi anki bolitai. Bolo Krishna bulbe jabe. Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobai. Radha Krishna bolo next shange cholo e matra bikaha chai. Turn the slide. Radha Krishna bolo. Hari bolo Radha Krishna bolo. Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Jai sakal vipod bhakti vinod bolin jakon om nam gai. Jai sakal vipod bhakti vinod bolin jakon om nam gai. Bhakti vinod hari bo bolo re jai sakal vipod. Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Shri Shri Radha Krishna bol bol bolo re shobha. Jai sakla vipod bhakti vinod bolin jakon om nam gai. Turn it, turn it. Jai. Radha Krishna bolo shange cholo e matra bikaha chai. Krishna bolbe jabe phula kahabe jorbi anki bolitai. Jeev Krishna dase vishwas kole to ar dukho nai. Miche maya boshe jacho beshe kacho habu dubu bai. Shikariya shabnariya preche niche gorni tai. Haribol, haribol, haribol ni tai gor haribol. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Bhaktivinoda, 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 Jaya Bhaktivinoda. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Premanande Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur ki. And now we're going to have a Pushpanjali ceremony. So in a very efficient but quick manner, we'll put away all the asans, we'll roll up this carpet, and we're going to gather around Srila Prabhupada and Srila Bhaktivinoda's Vyasasan, leaving a channel open so that they can see the deities. We'll pass around flowers so that everyone can have enough for 3 flower offerings. And then we'll connect to the entire parampara and then worship Bhaktivinoda Thakur with an offering of flowers in surrender. Thank you very much. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay. I turned it off for a sec. So now we're gonna offer to Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Okay, we have to have so much quiet we can hear one flower petal drop. Let's try it in 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. No potency. We need absolute complete silence for this offering. And this offering, of course, there are fruits and flowers that one can offer. Hare Krishna. One may offer fruits and flowers to to the Supreme Lord and the spiritual master. And it's, of course, the bhakti behind those that matters. But after all, Krishna grew the flower and he also grew the fruit. All we are doing is bringing it with a little bhakti. But when there's an offering of service, the devotees give their very life and soul to go out, to risk their lives, to go door to door, town to town, to distribute books. We consider this the greatest offering of fruits and flowers that one can give to the acharyas. So now we're going to have a reading done by our co-sankirtan leader, who prepared an offering of the books distributed during the Bhaktivinoda Thakur marathon. What's the crackling come from?
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Dear Bhaktivinoda Thakur, please accept our humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to you. Namo Bhakti Vinodaya Sachidananda Namine Gaura Shakti Swarupaya Rupanugavaratayate. I offer my respectful obeisances unto Sachidananda Bhakti Vinod, who is transcendental energy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He is a strict follower of Goswamis, headed by Srila Rupa Goswami. We are gathered here on the most auspicious occasion, the disappearance day of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, to offer the results of our monthly Sankirtan festival of Ambassador of Goodwill, which was held over little over 1 month here at ISV. It was Bhaktivinoda Thakur who said, Jivodaya Krishna Nam Sarvadam Sar. The showing of compassion to all fallen souls by distributing Krishna Nam is the essence of all religious principles. He revived the Sankirtan mission of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to spread the holy name and envisioned a marketplace for distributing it that would be the highest good to all living beings in this world. In 1896, in pioneering spirit, he sent the transcendental teachings of Sri Chaitanya beyond the tiny borders of India to the West in the form of a small booklet he had written in Sanskrit and translated in English, called Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, His Life and Percepts. The bold step would turn into very inspiring to future book distributors. 1896, it's the same auspicious year, Srila Prabhupada also appeared. The goals for this MSF were to distribute at least 135 Srimad Bhagavatam sets from the beginning of the year, to distribute at least 2,500 Bhagavad Gitas, learn to distribute books in Vietnamese language, brainstorm ideas of Srimad Bhagavatam Reading Club. We are pleased to report that all these goals have been met.
Hare Krishna!
Highlights. To accomplish these goals, the team ISV devotees held Harinam Sankirtan performance in Palo Alto and participated in massive book distribution all across the Bay Area and beyond over a period of 5 weeks. They went door to door through several apartment complexes in different cities, visited stories, community centers, nearby cities, and also distributed books in distant places such as Indonesia, Spain, and Hungary.
Harima!
Again, a well-organized Harinam was conducted at Palo Alto in pleasing manner. The place were reserved for this event. Smart box team led by Shalva Prabhu placed a new spot boxes all over the Bay Area. ISV kids team again did a huge by distributing Bhagavatams and Srimad Chaitanya Charitamrita sets at various venues like door to door, beach Sankirtan, university and Little Krishna kids. Totally, they distributed 21 Srimad Bhagavatam sets.
Harima!
And collected $4,028 in Lakshmi points.
Harima!
So Motal Gita team led by Mayapur Prabhu dispatched 3,600 Bhagavad Gitas again in this month.
Harima!
Haribo!
Team ISV distributed 35 signed Srimad Bhagavatam sets at Sadhu Sangha Festival.
Haribo!
Many devotees participated in each one and teach one program and took a personal vows to distribute Srimad Bhagavatam sets. Hansapriya Mataji distributed 21 Srimad Bhagavatam sets, which was our personal. And Sukeshwari Mataji did 14 Srimad Bhagavatam sets by herself. With the blessings of His Grace Vaisesika Prabhu and Navina Nirad Prabhu, first Sankirtan oriented seminar was conducted at ISKCON Madrid, Spain by Team ISV to self to introduce Srimad Bhagavatam sets and Bhagavad Gita's. Two Spanish sets were distributed at the temple.
Haribo!
Cow banks were introduced by ISV on the auspicious day of Panihati festival, along with a letter issued by His Grace Vaisesika Prabhu emphasized the importance of cow protection. Our collaborator Tom was also present on this day, who felt very encouraged after speaking to Vaisesika Prabhu and His Holiness Indradumna Maharaj. Logo for the Surabhi project also launched with the help of Jamuna Mataji. Ahimsa milk sales also increased by 10% in this month.
Haribo!
Summary of the scores. Here is a summary of the final results for the book distribution. In all, more than 74 devotees participated in book distribution.
Haribo!
5,843 books distributed, including 156 Srimad Bhagavatam sets.
Haribo!
This includes two Spanish Bhagavatam sets as well. So ISV also collected $38,835 in Lakshmi points.
Haribo!
On behalf of Team ISV, we express our thanks to all teams and team leaders who participated in monthly Sankirtan festival book distribution, with special thanks to Shraddha Devi Dasi and Ramananda Sakha Prabhu for generous donations, and to all donors for the generous contribution.
Haribo!
Without the hard work of all these devotees, the results would not have been possible. Our special thanks to His Grace Vaisesika Prabhu, whose enthusiasm and inspiration were instrumental in achieving these goals.
Haribo! Haribo! Haribo!
Monthly Sankirtan Festival of MSF of Ambassador of Goodwill Ki. Srila Prabhupada Ki. Bhaktivinoda Thakur Ki. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. And special thanks to Sri Krishna Purushottam Prabhu and Malini Devi Dasi for leading this effort, which has now not become a monthly Sankirtan festival, but a minute-to-minute Sankirtan Festival. Please, for Malini and Sri Krishna Purushottam. And now we're going to have a Pushpanjali, which is an offering of surrender from the heart to the great Acharya Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. We'll recite, I'll sing out the Mangalacharna prayers, and then you can repeat. And when we get to the very end, we'll come back to Bhaktivinoda Thakur's prayer. We'll repeat it three times. After each time we say his pranam mantra, we'll offer flowers to his lotus feet in surrender. And then we'll repeat that three times. Om Agyanati Mirandasya. Gyananjana Shalakaya. Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadahmayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Padakamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tamsajivam Sadvaitam Sadvadhutam Varijana Sahitam Shri Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakhanvitamscha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Sri Mate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavari Paschatya Deshatarine Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Tinamine Shri Barshabana Videvi Daitaya Kripabdaye Krishna Sambandha Vijnana Daine Prabhave Namaha Madhuryo Jvala Premadya Sri Rupanuga Bhaktida Sri Gora Karuna Shakti Vigrahaya Namostute Namaste Gauravani Sri Murtai Dinatarine Rupanuga Virudhapa Apa Siddhanta Dvanta Harine No Namo Gaurakishoraya Sakshad Vairagya Murtaye Vipralambara Sambode Padam Bhujayate Namaha Namo Bhaktivinodaya Sakchidananda Namine Gaura Shakti Swarupaya Rupanuga Varayate Gaura Virabhava Bhomestvam Nirdesa Sajjana Priyaha Vaishnava Sarva Bhoma Shri Jagannathaya Te Namaha Bancha Kalpatrubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyevacha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Namo Mahavaranyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gora Tushe Namaha Pancha Tadvatmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam Bhakta Avataram Bhaktakyam Namami Bhakta Shaktikam Hey Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabando Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Jayatam Surato Pangor Mama Manna Materagati Matsarva Swapadam Bojao Radha Madana Mohana Divya Vrindaranya Kalpadrumada Srimad Ratnangara Singhasanasta Srimad Radha Srila Govinda Deva Prishtali Bisevya Manu Smarami Sriman Rasarasarambi Vamshiva Tatatastitaha Karshan Venu Swaner Gopir Gopinatha Shri Estunaha Tapta Kanchan Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasari Gaura Bhaktivrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Before we say the prayers to Bhaktivinoda Thakur, I'd like to say that the entire book distribution program, which the other day Sukeshwari in her announcements, to quote her, said, is huge at ISV. It was really started by the mercy of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Of course, we began the monthly Sankirtan festivals in earnest, shooting for bigger and bigger goals, beginning in 2006, I believe, with Bhaktivinoda Thakur's special Disappearance Day festival. And every time we've come up to it, we've thought, how will we do more? How will we do again? And every time, by his mercy, we succeed. So we thank Bhaktivinoda Thakur from the bottom of our hearts for giving us shelter in this service. We pray to him that we may increase unlimitedly, of course, in increments. But please, if you so desire, let us increase the Sankirtan movement all over the Bay Area so that it makes a huge mark on the earth. We want the planes flying over to be able to see the chanting and dancing going on. Thank you for considering our request. Hare Krishna. Namo Bhaktivinodaya.
Namo Bhaktivinodaya.
Sakchidananda Namine.
Gaura Shakti Swarupaya.
Rupanuga Varayate. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur Ki Jai. Esha Bhushpanjali. Jai Bhaktivinoda Thakur Ki Jai. Namo Bhaktivinodaya. Sakchidananda Namine. Gaura Shakti Swarupaya. Rupanuga Varayate. Esha Pushpanjali. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur Ki Jai. Namo Bhaktivinodaya. Sakchidananda Namine. Gaura Shakti Swarupaya. Rupanuga Varayate. Esha Pushpanjali. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur Ki Jai. Namah.